graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Fred the Vampire Accountant 4, The Fangs of Freelance by Drew Hayes. Narrated by Christopher Walker and performed by a full cast.
Happy birthday!
We all leapt out from behind couches, chairs, and in Bubba's case, an oversized armoire that I'm almost certain was brought in specifically for him to hide behind.
What?
Neil dropped the stack of books he'd been carrying and leapt backward, smacking directly into Albert. Luckily, zombies weren't pushovers. Forgive the literal use of an expression. So he managed to steady the shocked necromancer as Neil fully recovered his bearings.
How did you all know?
And just what kind of mentor would I be if I forgot my student's 18th birthday?
Amy made her way over to Neil, shaking her head all the way. It was a small gesture, but notable because small flecks of rainbow-colored light swirled away from her hair. Amy's usual penchant for testing alchemic products on herself had evidently taken a festive turn for the occasion. Ah, but if that last statement made no sense to you, then perhaps this is the best moment to pause briefly and explain. My name is Frederick Frankfurt Fletcher, and I am an accountant by trade. Also, I'm a vampire. Yes, I probably should have led with that second bit, but to be honest, the accountant part factors far more frequently into my daily life than does my status as an undead American. Aside from a sunlight allergy, a predominantly liquid diet, bought through appropriate and legal sources, thank you very much, and the power to work for days at a time, being a vampire hadn't changed me much. It had, however, dramatically impacted my social circle. From Crystal, my girlfriend who worked for a parahuman policing organization known as the Agency, to Neil and Albert, a pair of best friends who also happened to be a necromancer and zombie, respectively, all the way to the very house we were standing in, since Charlotte Manor was a living entity with unique powers all her own. While I'd had very few friends as a human, my parahuman social circle was full to near bursting, a fact that I was always grateful for. Charlotte appeared next to me. Although her exact appearance varied with the occasion and her mood, Charlotte was tonight dressed in one of her usual gowns. It looked as if it had been pulled straight out of a Victorian romance, complete with a wide skirt that had to use magic to avoid knocking things over.
Dinner will be ready in 10 minutes, Fred.
Since most of us rented some form of space or another from Charlotte, be it offices or living quarters, meals were part of the package, not to mention one of her greatest selling features. Even if it was woven together mostly from magic, Charlotte was a fantastic chef, and she'd agreed to put together something special for the evening's festivities.
I'm going to be a waiter coming around with champagne, beer, and soda in a few minutes as well. Also, Arch and Lillian have both asked me to send you to their respective quarters as soon as possible.
I'd been wondering where the newest employee of Fletcher Accounting Services was, as Lillian was rarely one to miss a party, or any of Charlotte's meals. In the months since she'd been freed from her old vampire clan and joined the one I'd hastily founded, the House of Fred, thanks to Crystal muddling with the paperwork, she'd slowly been acclimating to life outside a rigorously controlled organization. Arch, on the other hand, generally only popped in for brief stints between missions and often took his meals in his room. Though, given that he was training Albert, and therefore Neil by extension, I had somewhat expected him to make it down. Some manner of agency task had probably demanded his attention instead, since he was employed by the same people as Crystal. Neither of them spoke much about work due to the secretive nature of what they did, but I was slowly piecing enough together to suspect that despite their both being called agent, they had a lot of differences in their actual jobs. Charlotte, when Lillian asked me to come by, was she hunched over a large stack of documents or swearing at her laptop?
The latter. It's actually quite nostalgic. I haven't heard some of those curses being thrown about for decades.
Charlotte smiled, looking briefly wistful for the tenants who had constructed her a very long time ago.
But she didn't break anything in frustration, so I'd say she's making progress.
Well, that made the choice of who to see first simple. Lillian was working on her study materials and some small-scale assignments I'd handed over, so she was likely calling me for help. The woman was a hard worker and a dedicated student, making tremendous progress in learning the trade of accounting. But no one could master the craft without occasional bits of guidance. If she was asking for assistance, then it must be something quite difficult. It was probably better if I encouraged her to take the night off for Neil's party and deal with the issue tomorrow. But even that might require some convincing, as she was determined to get her credentials as soon as possible. Better to start with Arch, who was nothing if not quick to the point in every conversation. The term blunt had been bandied about more than once when discussing him. So had heartless and robot, although I'd found that Arch did have some sentimentality in him. It just required a keen eye and lots of patience to spot. Tell Lillian I'll be there in 10 minutes, and let Arch know I'm on my way, please. While I didn't see Charlotte so much as move a step, I knew versions of her were relaying the message as I headed over to Neil. Although the two of us had never gotten along as well as I did with most of the others, it would have been rude to slip away without so much as even a cursory greeting to the birthday boy. I waited my turn behind Bubba, who delivered a handshake so hearty I feared for the necromancer's bones. He finally finished, stepping to the side and helping himself to a cold silver can from the tray held by one of Charlotte's waiter forms. Stepping closer, I met Neil's eyes and stuck out my own hand. Happy birthday, and welcome to the official world of adulthood. Despite the fact that I'd been looking at Neil, I couldn't help but notice a brief expression flash across Albert's nearby face. The look stood out to me not because of its severity, but rather its strangeness. Albert was a perpetually cheerful, upbeat person, which is what made the flicker of sadness in his eyes seem so alien. Before I could dwell or comment on it, Neil had taken my hand and given it a shake.
Thanks, Fred.
Then the exchange was done, and I moved away to let Neil begin partaking in the festivities. As the party moved toward the dining room, a once more smiling Albert with them, I headed upstairs to see Arch. Looking back, I should have been wondering why he would summon me to a meeting, but my mind was stuck in that moment with Albert. Besides, I was assuming this would be more non-news from the agency. When I'd officially founded my parahuman clan to fend off the aggression from other vampires moving into town, I'd also signed Fletcher Accounting Services up to do freelance work with the agency. It was a dangerous alliance that wouldn't endear me to most other parahumans, but it had given me and my friends a measure of protection from the House of Turva. Yet, in the months since I'd signed on, no work had come. Every time I asked Arch, he'd merely told me that my application was under review. I expected more of the same as I knocked on his slightly ajar door and walked through, but at a glance, I knew I was wrong. Arch was zipping up a small duffel bag, one I'd seen him carry with him when leaving many a time. He was dressed in layers, as usual, and I knew from experience that hidden amidst those folds of cloth were weapons designed to take down countless types of creatures. Of all my friends, Arch was the only one whose parahuman nature remained a mystery to me. No one talked about it, especially not Arch, and I never asked. Partly out of politeness, partly because I suspected that I wouldn't like the answer. Sometimes in the parahuman world, ignorance was preferable. I'd learned that lesson by asking an ancient dragon one too many questions.
Charlotte, would you mind putting my gift for Neil with the others?
Arch nodded to a small package in dark purple wrapping paper on his dresser.
If you know where Fred's is, get that too. I'm afraid we're going to miss the party.
Do I get to ask why we'll be missing it? I hadn't moved from the doorway, but that didn't stop Charlotte from walking by me and scooping up Arch's gift. She said nothing as she made her way past, although this time I did step aside for her. Charlotte was an expert at knowing when to be a landlord, a friend, or a house.
I think you've already put it together, but if you want confirmation, word came down a few minutes ago. Your freelance application has been processed. It's time to move on to the interview and skills portion.
Which means meeting them in person. I'll get my briefcase and laptop. Are we heading into town? If so, I'd like to pop by my apartment and change into something more professional. Truth be told, I wasn't in what most would call a casual ensemble, with my button-down shirt, khakis, and sweater vest. But if I was meeting someone in the agency, I felt like I should go for a full suit. Arch stared at me for several seconds before shaking his head.
No, Fred, we're not going into town. I just told you, I'm taking you for an interview and skills test.
Right, which I took to mean that there's a representative in Winslow, probably staying at Richards or something. I mean, it's not like they'd invite me to their actual offices, the locations of which I assume are national secrets. Arch lifted the duffel bag and tossed it easily over his shoulder, a show of surprising strength for his short stature and slight frame.
Our fiscal people tend to stay at the offices, and they're the ones who are interviewing you. That means it's my job to take you to them. You were right about one thing, though.
Reaching into his pocket, Arch produced a thick swath of dark fabric and tossed it over to me. I snared it from midair and unfolded the item, quickly realizing what I'd been handed. It was a hood to cover my head, and based on the small arcane runes woven into the fabric, I had a hunch it was strong enough to block out even my enhanced senses.
The location is a secret. Once we're in the plane, I'll need you to put that on.
Folding the hood carefully and tucking it into my pocket, I considered the situation. May I have half an hour to help Lillian and say my goodbyes? I'd like to at least explain why I'm ditching out on Neil's party.
No one down there needs an explanation, Fred. They know what a summons from the agency means.
Arch glanced down at his watch and stared at it for several long moments.
But I did pack fast, so I can give you 15 minutes to grab your stuff and say whatever you want to everyone.
Thank you, Arch. The one upside to the hood was that it blocked out the bickering. And that was truly an amazing accomplishment. While I rarely have use for them, outside of sniffing the bouquet from a fine glass of Pinot Noir, vampire senses are quite exceptional. So it was all the more impressive that immediately after donning it, I could no longer hear Crystal squabbling with Arch. The 15 minutes of goodbyes had been relatively painless, although 10 of those were spent helping Lillian along in her work and rapidly setting up plans for how she and Albert were to handle any business that might come in over the next few days. Theoretically, I'd still have email, but when dealing with parahumans, it pays to put contingency plans in place. Better they be able to let inquisitive clients know I was temporarily away on business than have people who trusted me with their finances think I'd suddenly skipped town. It wasn't until Arch and I went downstairs to let the party know we would be leaving early that we hit something of an issue. Most took the news with immediate acceptance. They understood that when the agency called, it was unwise to refuse, especially for someone who needed their protection as much as we all did. The House of Turva hadn't taken the slights against them lightly, and the moment they saw a weakness, they'd pounce on it. While originally that would have only impacted me, everyone had signed on to join my clan, albeit without my knowledge, which meant they'd be targets as well. The agency and some official alliances with friends were all that kept the angry vampires at bay. Crystal, however, had not reacted well to the news of my being suddenly pulled away. She was unhappy that the order to bring me in had come to Arch rather than her. Although, given our personal relationship, I understood why her higher-ups would make that call. Not that I said anything to that effect, mind you. I may have put myself in life-threatening situations several times over the past few years, but I wasn't so suicidal as to disagree with Crystal when she was angry. In the end, she'd decided to accompany us. Arch had voiced his disapproval, to which Crystal had responded by pointing out that she was an agent and could go to headquarters whenever she damn well pleased. There were also a lot of suggestions as to what Arch should do with his opinions, most of which centered around him shoving them places, but I'll omit those for the sake of brevity and tact. Once we were finally out of the house, it was a short car ride to a private airstrip where a plane was waiting for us. I'd have been impressed by such opulent transportation for a mere interview if I hadn't seen how free the agency was with providing air transport in the past. If they did actually bring me on to do some finance work, one of the first things I'd suggest would be having agents fly commercial more often. Surely not every trip demanded such expensive privacy. After that, there was nothing to recall but darkness. Nearly every sense I had was completely muted, which was actually a rather strange experience in itself. Sort of like being asleep while staying lucid. The one change I was able to register came during the flight, when I felt a familiar hand lay itself in mine and interweave our fingers. Crystal had apparently switched from arguing with Arch to comforting me. I can't say how long we were like that, or even how much time passed at all. Floating in darkness, it becomes difficult to keep track of things like minutes drifting by. There was simply the void around me, the hand in mine, and the occasional shake as the plane moved along. Then, without warning, the plane bounced twice, and I realized that we had landed. I waited for someone to help me up, no doubt guiding me to a car that would bring us from the airport to our location. Instead, the plane rolled along the ground for a while before finally coming to a full stop. Moments later, my hood was peeled away, and I found myself peering into Crystal's lovely brown eyes.
Hey, Freddy. We're here.
I looked around at the plane and out the windows, not entirely sure what to expect. From what I could see, we were in a hangar, although it might have just as easily been a giant metal warehouse. There were no windows, just a closed set of heavy steel doors where the plane had presumably come through, along with a smaller matching set at the other side of the building. Outside, Arch was talking to someone in a pilot's uniform as he smoked his way through what would in no way be his only cigarette of the day. Putting it all together, I did some mental calculations and positively reeled. Crystal, does your agency employ the use of a private airstrip?
Sure do. They used to just land at nearby ones, but building one on site made things a lot easier for all of us.
Do you have any idea how much that must cost? I mean, for as many planes as you'd need to be flying to make it pragmatic, the fuel costs alone...
You talk about numbers and costs a lot when you get nervous, you know? But you don't need to be scared. This is my office, Freddy. It's a place of business. They just want to see if you've got the chops to be a useful freelancer.
Given that our tentative status is all that's keeping some very unhappy vampires at bay, I'd say this situation comes with ample reason to be nervous. Looking down, I realized our hands were still intertwined. In the rush of my senses coming back, I had failed to notice that. What if I mess this up? Failing to land a client is one thing. Falling short here could come with very dire consequences.
First off, even if something did go wrong today, which it won't, the House of Terva still can't risk moving against you. Not with Richard's people being official House of Fred allies. And secondly, are you really worried about this? Come on, Freddy. I know you lack confidence, but this is accounting. Even you have to admit that this is your jam. The booming business is proof enough.
I'm good with numbers, not people. And Arch specifically called this an interview. I rose from my seat, but I suppose I'm going to have to try and make a good impression anyway. Crystal got up from her chair as well, finally letting go of my hand as she smoothed the wrinkles in her red blouse.
Just be you, Freddy. That's always been enough for us, and I'm sure it'll go over well in the interviews. After all, it's not like you'll be interviewing with agents. You're going to talk to other numbers people. I bet you'll mention investment accounts and they'll get all tingly. And by the time this is done, all of you will be overhauling the agency's pension plan.
You get pensions?
Shit, yeah. Government job, Freddy. Get all kinds of perks. But lots of free time isn't among them, so shake a leg.
Crystal swatted me on the rear, and the two of us headed down the plane's folded-out stairs. By the time we reached the ground, Arch was already on his second cigarette, and the pilot had wandered off. Wordlessly, Arch nodded as we approached, and then led us to the small set of doors at the far end of the building. They were metal, incredibly thick, with no handle in sight. Instead, there was only a small keypad to the left side of them. Arch punched in a few numbers.
Agent Davenport escorting Frederick Fletcher for an interview and skills test, as assigned. Also, Agent Jenkins is here.
I was still trying to process the facts that A, I'd never heard Arch's last name before, and B, it was Davenport, when the doors began sliding open. They parted to reveal a short hallway that ended in another set of identical metal doors. Interestingly, this short stretch of interior was painted a crisp white color, which made all the runes and arcane scribblings covering every inch stand out all the more. Some of it I semi-recognized from glimpses at Amy and Neil's books, or the night I saw dragon magic woven around a building, but by far, the majority was completely alien. Arch stepped in immediately, while Crystal waited for me to take my first step before following. No sooner had we entered than the doors behind us sealed shut. I'm guessing this is the agency's version of airport security scanners?
If the airport scanners were designed to detect enchantments, shape changers, illusions, or a myriad of other tricks some parahuman might use to try and sneak their way in, then yes, it would be just like them.
Arch finished his cigarette and dropped it into the small box he always kept on hand for disposing of butts and ashes. They probably didn't let him smoke indoors here either, which explained the surly response. Arch had a tendency to get grumpy when he had to quit smoking even for a brief period of time, which happened with exceptional regularity. Charlotte had created a smoking lounge in the manor just for Arch, although occasionally Richard, Bubba, and Crystal would adjourn there to puff on oversized cigars. Whatever magic was working around us, to me it felt like we were simply standing in a hallway with weird writing all over the place. Evidently, and thankfully, none of us tripped any alarms, and soon the second set of doors began to part. This time, there wasn't another hallway full of magical symbols awaiting us. In fact, it looked almost conspicuously mundane on the other side. Fluorescent lights, cheap gray carpeting, and a white-tiled ceiling made it identical to countless other offices all throughout the nation. The only thing that stood out was the man waiting for us on the other side. He was lean, almost gaunt, really, with a head so perfectly bald and pale that it seemed like someone had painted a face on an egg and set it atop a scarecrow in a suit. His smile was surprisingly affable, though, and the man greeted us as we stepped out from the magic-scanning hallway.
Agent Davenport, Agent Jenkins, good to see you both again. Mr. Fletcher, it's a pleasure to make your acquaintance. Your reputation as an accountant precedes you. My name is Roderick Knox, and I am the head of the agency's finance division. I'm also the man who will be interviewing you today. Can I get you anything? Water? Blood? I know the summons came out of the blue, so I'll understand if you need to eat.
Roderick's office was substantial. Not the biggest I'd ever laid eyes on, but certainly sizable enough to mark his importance to the agency. It was also unexpectedly comforting. The sight of file cabinets, stacks of folders, and an out-of-date desktop were familiar hallmarks to my corporate accounting days, which made me feel far more at home than I normally would have in a secret location for a government agency. No, thank you. As a rule, I always keep some emergency blood on hand for just such occasions. Reaching into my briefcase, I held up the enchanted flask I'd picked up in Borback, Texas. Between having to run from a vampire hunter and getting stuck for days in the mansion of a pair of bickering mage siblings, I'd discovered it was prudent to always have more nutrition on hand than might seem necessary. Roderick took note of the flask and sat down at his desk, which was both spacious and impossible to see under the thick layer of documents covering it.
Prepared for the unexpected. I like that. It's an attitude that will serve you well if you work with us.
In working with parahuman clients, I've found preparation and redundancy to be indispensable tools.
Yes, let's talk about your prior work.
Roderick reached into a drawer under his desk and pulled out a thick, cream-colored folder, the same brand I kept in my own office for compiling documents. Despite the folders being an industry standard, I suddenly felt a curious kinship with the bald man before me. Just like parahumans, accountants have a culture of their own.
In life, you did good work. Always precise, but never especially aggressive in terms of taking on new responsibilities. Post-death, however, you've shown far more initiative and entrepreneurial spirit. You founded Fletcher Accounting Services, gained a certified public parahuman license, and almost immediately began taking on a wealth of new clients, many of whom were high profile. Very high profile in a few cases.
Although I rarely dwelled on it, Roderick was right that some of my friends held stations far above my own.
Are you referring to the Clover siblings?
No. Wealthy as they are, that duo is hardly the most prestigious account on your record. I was referring to your work with Gideon, the King of the West.
To be fair, Gideon never directly engaged my services. I was called in to work for Richard Alderson, and handling Gideon's finances was simply part of the package. It wouldn't feel proper for me to claim him as a client. Roderick gave me a long, careful look before flipping to the next file. He was clearly searching my face for something, but I wasn't entirely sure what it might be. If nothing else, I took comfort in the fact that so far, I'd only told the truth. So if he was hunting for signs of falsehoods, he would come up short.
Proper or not, he's part of your client history. As are the aforementioned Clover siblings, Richard Alderson and many of his Therians, the enchanted home that houses two of our agents and countless other parahumans. To be honest, Mr. Fletcher, I'd heard your name well before the application to work as a freelancer ever came across my desk. There was some worry from up top that you were up to something, so I was asked to look over your paper trail for any discrepancies. What I found instead was a meticulous, well-prepared set of documents on every occasion. You do fine work, and from the testimonials we've gathered, all of your business practices are above board.
Beg pardon, but what do you mean by testimonials? I very much hope you haven't been bothering my clients about this. I'll admit, this objection might seem a touch petty. However, my time as a CPPA had cast a light on just how highly many parahumans valued their privacy, especially where the agency was concerned. If they'd been hunting down and pestering people that had used my company, then word would spread, and within a year, I'd likely be filing for bankruptcy.
Only the ones we already had official dealings with. As a rule, we tend to let the parahumans who want their distance from us have it, at least so long as they don't do anything that requires reprimanding.
That is somewhat reassuring. So, my reputation is good, and you've evaluated my work, which means you know I'm competent. Roderick lifted a single finger into the air to halt me before I could continue.
I know the work I've seen is competent. Beyond that, really, the work is exceptional. Whether you are actually the one doing it or not has yet to be determined.
It took me several moments to fully process what Roderick was suggesting. Hold on. Do you think I've been acting as the face of the company, only to shove the actual accounting onto someone else? How does that make sense, given my career and life? For that matter, who would choose me as the face of a company? I gestured to myself for good measure. While I don't find myself especially hideous, I was self-aware enough to know I hardly came off as smooth or classically handsome, and my taste in clothing wasn't entirely aligned with what was trendy and hip.
Mr. Fletcher, as a rule, the agency doesn't assume competence when looking for scams or tricks. Just because a plan is bad doesn't mean someone might not try to pull it. And this one does make a certain amount of sense. As a vampire and former accountant, you make the perfect front. Strong enough to deal with more powerful parahumans as a peer, experienced enough to sell the story. That said, on a personal level, I think you're on the up and up. Part of my parahuman nature allows me to have a keen sense for liars, and your words ring consistently true. However, we are a branch of the government, and doing work for us would allow you access to highly restricted documents. We would be remiss if we didn't do our due diligence in making sure you were the real deal.
I suppose I understand. I didn't love the implied accusation, but Arch had been upfront about the fact that this was an interview and skills assessment. Really, the whole situation was rather ideal. If the hardest hurdle I had to clear was proving I knew my stuff as an accountant, that was something I could do. The interview was the harder part, and as Roderick closed the folder and stowed it in his desk once more, it became clear that our chat was winding down.
I had a feeling you would.
He opened another drawer, and this time, Roderick held the contents out to me. It was a small stack of papers, which I accepted and began looking over while he continued.
Those are our standard non-disclosures, although I'd still recommend fully reading each page, as what the agency considers standard and what the rest of the world uses are far from identical. The long and short of it is that from this point on, if you share any of the information you see with someone who lacks proper clearance, which would essentially be all non-agents, there will be serious consequences.
I flipped ahead a little to see what Roderick was referring to, and found myself thankful that as a vampire, I had a naturally pale skin tone. Otherwise, the blood might have visibly drained from my face as I read over what happened to those who broke the non-disclosure. Serious consequences was accurate, but it somewhat belied the harshness of what was waiting for those who spilled agency secrets. Even if I didn't go pale, my expression still evidently betrayed my concern.
I realize the penalties are a bit stiff. Try to understand, this agency is tasked with keeping parahumans in check and obedient to their treaties. Our reputation for efficiency and ruthlessness is a huge part of that. If we had people walking around babbling on about things they shouldn't, it would undercut our image. And that is something we simply cannot tolerate.
Making a mental note to never talk about my freelance work, even in general terms, to anyone, ever, I pulled a pen from my pocket and began etching my signature onto the document. Harsh as the penalties were, they still only applied to those who told tales they shouldn't. As a professional accountant, I'd already known the importance of confidentiality and discretion in my trade. Upping the stakes for failure was scary, true, but on a fundamental level, it really didn't change anything about my job. Mind if I ask you a question, Mr. Knox?
Please, call me Roderick. And by all means, feel free to ask whatever you like.
Then I insist you call me Fred, as nearly everyone else already does. I paused, reading a small section twice, then finally initialing next to it. Forgive me if this is pressing too much, but I'm curious. You use a lot of we terms when referring to the agency and its employees. Am I to understand that even the finance department and its workers are considered to be agents? The smile stretched across Roderick's face slowly, like a cat that had just woken from a long nap in sunshine.
No, the majority are just people who are good with numbers. I'm something of an exception, in that I had skills that made me useful in the field while also adept at handling finances. I spent a few decades working as an agent, but decided to leave field work behind and pursue something a little more stable. Don't worry, Fred. No one is expecting you to do what Agent Jenkins or Agent Davenport do. We'd just be looking to lean on you in hectic times, as even this department can get flooded and perhaps do the occasional external audit or finance assessment.
An agent and an accountant. And here I thought I was the oddball for choosing this job as a vampire.
There aren't many who straddle both lines, and most of them are greeds like me.
It took several seconds for Roderick to notice the blank stare on my face as I waited for an explanation.
Fred, have you never dealt with half-demons before?
For a moment, I nearly broke the pen in my hand. The only thing related to Hellfire I'd encountered was Crystal, after she'd had her throat slit. And that had been a truly terrifying experience. As I understood it, Crystal's soul played prison to a powerful, evil entity that had been sealed in her bloodline generations ago. If she died, it died. So it manifested when she was gravely injured, turning her from functionally human to one of the most dangerous creatures in the world, albeit temporarily. Thankfully, I remembered that Crystal had very specifically referred to what she had as a devil, whereas demons were lesser creatures. Half-demons would be new to me. I've never met one in Winslow.
With Agent Jenkins there, you likely wouldn't have. Many of my kind avoid her type out of instinct, even if they don't understand why. Half-demons can, if they wish, live as normal humans. So long as we don't feed our demon selves, we are functionally mortal. However, if we do allow our demon sides to feed, then we gain strength, longevity, toughness, the usual parahuman boons, along with some perks depending on our exact nature. What among the seven deadly sins is food for us depends on our demonic heritage. Mine, for example, is the sin of greed. Hanging around casinos or stock brokerages will fill me up in no time. That's why we tend to refer to ourselves by our natures. Thus, I am known as a greed.
Wow. That is a new one by me. I stared at him for a little longer than was necessary, still watching for a pair of horns or a burst of hellfire to spring forth. Instead, there was just a patient expression waiting for me to finish my paperwork. With a few more signatures, I closed my pen and handed the stack of documents back over to Roderick.
The parahuman world is a wide one, and if you work with us, you'll learn more about it than you ever would have in Colorado.
Roderick checked the pages over, then tucked them back into his desk.
For now, though, I'm going to get everything prepared. When it's ready, we'll take you to a designated room and give you some sample work to do. Assuming your skills live up to your reputation, your freelancing application will be approved. It will take about half an hour, so I'd advise you to drink some blood and maybe grab a coffee. I'm sure Agent Jenkins will show you the way. When I'm ready, I'll have Agent Davenport bring you down.
Roderick rose from his desk, so I took the cue and followed suit.
Good luck, Fred. I truly hope you're able to join us, even if only as a freelancer.
Well, at least that made two of us, even if we wanted the same outcome for very different reasons.
Come look, this is my desk.
Crystal dragged me across the cheap gray carpet through a large room full of desks. It was, as I recalled from my corporate days, referred to as an open concept office, which always felt to me like a fun way to say that a company didn't want to spend the money on cubicle walls. Then again, given how rarely Crystal ever actually seemed to visit her home office, it did make a certain amount of sense that they wouldn't want to dedicate too much floor space to agents. We moved briskly through the largely empty room, as apparently she wasn't the only agent who spent most of her time in the field. The lone exception was a tall woman in the back, so broad-shouldered she could have been Richard's cousin, and a pale male several feet away that I instantly recognized as a fellow vampire. That explained why there hadn't been any windows since we walked in, at least. They had to keep the place parahuman-friendly at all hours of the day.
This is me.
Crystal pointed to a desk that was almost identical to every other one on the floor, save for the fact that it was messier, and had three picture frames bunched up near her computer's monitor. The first was of a couple I might not have recognized if Crystal and I didn't share a hometown, but I'd seen her mother and father often enough to know who I was looking at. They lined up a little too well with my memory, actually, which meant the photo was an old one. Not surprising, since her mother had passed away while Crystal was in college. The next photo was filled with familiar faces. It was inside Charlotte Manor, and featured every one of our friends. Even Charlotte was there, dressed in a festive flapper outfit. Is this from the night we drove off Petra?
You know it. Everyone was there and dressed snazzy, so it seemed like a good picture for the desk.
My eyes moved to the final photo in the line, and had I been human, I'd have blushed so thoroughly that the other vampire's stomach would have rumbled from the amount of blood in my face. This was a picture of Crystal and I, taken mid-kiss. Given the angle, she'd clearly held up her phone to snap a photo, doing it so slyly I hadn't even noticed. I would have posed for a regular photograph.
Freddy, you always look stiff when we try to take regular pictures. I wanted one where you were you, and that meant getting your guard down.
She leaned in close.
But if you want to do a reshoot, I'm always game.
Although my embarrassment deepened, and I frantically glanced around to see if we'd been overheard, I still appreciated what Crystal was doing. She knew I was nervous, and was trying to keep me from getting too in my head. Not that she wouldn't have done the same thing in other circumstances. I often suspected my public shyness toward affection was why she loved teasing me so much. However, she might have been a bit less overt normally. Maybe when we get home. At the moment, I'm afraid all I'd be thinking about is whatever test awaits me.
Is that a challenge? Because if you think I can't take your mind off numbers, then challenge...
Chris!
Suddenly, Crystal had a pair of toned, slender arms wrapped around her in a loose hug. June's speed was impressive. I literally just scanned the room and seen no sign of her. Then again, as a half-fae, she had more than a few advantages in her favor. Once she released my girlfriend, I noticed that June didn't look quite the same as before. Aside from the external alterations, such as her favoring jeans and sneakers rather than overalls this time, her eyes had also changed color. Before, they were a lavender that worked well with her blue-white hair, but today they gleamed a deep cerulean color. I hadn't realized those with fae blood could shift such things, although that was hardly surprising, given how little I knew about parahumans overall. There were just so many types of us, and each with our own quirks and traits.
Hey, Fred. Good to see you two.
June gave me a brief hug, Nothing like the embrace she'd thrust upon Crystal, but still a steep improvement from our first time meeting at Calcucon.
What are you doing here? Get wrangled into filing some reports?
No, we just got our assignments. There's a nest of...
June's eyes darted to me. It began to dawn on me that I was something of an invader to the agents here, my presence restricting their ability to speak freely. After seeing the non-disclosure that Roderick had given me, I could see how seriously they all took confidentiality.
A nest of bad things. In a place that need clearing out. What about you? You never come to the office unless you have to. And I don't recall Fred having clearance.
He's applying to do some freelance accounting work, and I came along for support. Well, support and to make sure he didn't panic and lock himself in a broom closet. Mostly support, though.
Crystal and June turned to look behind me. Both of them had instantaneous reactions. Crystal's relaxed posture turned stiff, and her cheerful face grew unexpectedly harsh. For her part, June merely went from happy to uncomfortable. Even before I started to turn, I already knew what would be awaiting me there. I am, as indicated by job and history, good with numbers, and this wasn't a difficult situation to add up. June had been saying "we" a lot during her description of activities. That meant she was here with someone. I didn't know a lot of agents, but I could think of one who would garner such reactions from these two. The likeliest candidate to go on a mission with June that would cause Crystal to suddenly turn harsh was June's own brother, the agent who also happened to be Crystal's ex-fiancé. Sure enough, the man behind me was definitely related to June. Same blue-white hair, same inhuman beauty, with flawless skin and powerful bone structure. Aside from gender, the biggest difference between the two was eye color, as he currently had a deep orange, and fashion sense. While June seemed to favor comfort and function, like Crystal, this man was wearing an impeccable suit that had clearly been tailored specifically to fit his lean form. While I'd known since meeting June that Crystal's old flame was a fellow half-fae, and therefore would be far more handsome than any human could equal, it was still intimidating to meet him in person. This was the sort of man Crystal had dated before me?
Fred, let me introduce you to my brother, September Winbrook.
June had snapped out of her momentary awkward coma and stepped over next to the newcomer.
Bro, this is Frederick. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.